Its Land and Sea Park in the Bahamas is one of the oldest marine protected areas in the world, a man-made sanctuary in the sea. The waters teem with life, from the smallest to the largest creature in the food chain, because they are protected from the most efficient predator our oceans have ever known.
I reckon a few fish off that point,
cast a fly, straight out. Oh, what's that?
Probably a bat.
Look, there.
Hey.
Look. Rupert, there's fish here.
I came into this because, in a very small and very limited way, I was a hunter of fish.
My first salmon, also the largest I ever caught. Here we come. On a Welsh river, 23 pounds. I was chuffed to bits to catch that. Huge fin. I have never been more proud of myself.
It was the last that anybody caught on that beat for years and years. I don't think anybody's caught one as big as that since. And I was triumphant, but I also have felt guilty about that fish ever since, because it was one of the last of a spring run that now no longer happens. Now, why were fewer of them coming back? Well, I didn't know, but I thought I'd better find out. And that's really what set me off on this journey to find out what was happening to fish in the sea.
It's Clover, Charles Clover.
I've got some queries.
Sir?
What is the tuna that you serve? Which ocean is it from and how is it caught?
As a journalist, what changed my view of the sea is when I walked into the wrong press conference in The Hague in 1990. And this was the first presentation I'd ever seen about the effect of trawling upon the seabed and upon the creatures that lived on it. And what they said was that trawling with a beam trawler was like ploughing a field seven times a year. And I'm a farmer's son, and I thought to myself, how many crops would grow if you ploughed that field seven times a year? And I thought, not very much at all. And that changed my whole view of what was going on in the sea.
Our view of the sea has always been that it is huge, beautiful, and inexhaustible. The oceans are the common heritage of all mankind. and for billions of years, they have been full of life.
These huge resources, these that we once believed to be renewable, that our whole human history has led us up to now to believe that are renewable, are not renewable anymore because of what we're doing to them. And so our entire philosophical approach has to change. It's not going to be the same in the future as it was in the past. That's where we are now.
What a crunch, it's truly fact, not fable. Cod fillet so fine, golden crisp every time. Comes from the captain's table.
We never used to think about where our fish came from, but in fact, they are wild animals. And we found that out to our cost for the first time in Newfoundland. For centuries, the waters in northern Canada teemed with unbelievable amounts of codfish. Legend had it that you could walk across their backs on the water. The cod was so plentiful, the communities thrived on fishing. As the years went on, technology improved. The boats got bigger and catches increased. The bounty seemed endless. Then, in 1992, the unthinkable happened.
In St. John's tonight, angry fishermen vented their rage. They charged the room where John Crosby was holding a news conference, but security would not let them in.
What had once been the most abundant cod population in the world had been fished out of existence.
I've decided that effective at midnight tonight,
there will be a moratorium on harvesting of northern cod until the spring of 1994.
Either we cooperate in addressing it, or there's going to be no fish for anybody. No fish for the Europeans, no fish for the Canadians. And an ecological catastrophe on our hands.
With or without you, with or without you, and not only me, every fisherman in this island, we're going fishing.
Overnight, 40,000 people lost their jobs.
The cod is gone, and I think within the context of cod, particularly in the Canadian perspective, is that this is a species that has been fished for centuries and centuries. Cod was the reason that people migrated from the UK.